Thanks everybody for coming and enjoying and participating in the day and a half, two days worth of activities here on this conference. I really want to start by thanking Hao Wang and Sarah Belford and the whole organizing committee for all of the hard work that you guys did putting this conference together. It really is first rate. I've heard a lot of good things coming out of the sessions, and so congratulations to you guys. Thank you. I hope everybody's enjoyed the conversation so far. I think it's really been kind of provocative and certainly on topic for what the country is grappling with. The issues about the future, the issues about people's place and groups' place in the future. We're really, for the first time in our nation's history, or certainly in the last 30, 40 years, have a whole generation who are not confident that their future will be better, their children's future will be better than their parents'. And for some groups, it's particularly acute. The sense of alienation, the sense of feeling left behind has been pretty strong, and we've been focusing on over the course of the last couple of days discussion about four particular groups: voters, the unemployed and underemployed youth, regional independence movements, and refugees and asylees. And so this question about how these groups feel in terms of both in the United States and around the globe, how they become included in the overall conversation about progress is a key one. And so it's great that we have people thinking about both their feelings, their senses of not being included, as well as what's the objective reality, not what are the conditions that are guiding their lives, where are they, what are their positions, what are some of the things we can think about doing as solutions. But we have to understand both the personal side, the feeling side, the perception side, as well as some of the objective realities and barriers. And so these conversations can be tough. They're not going to be resolved in a day. But I think the kind of conversations we're having today is a beginning. It's a start. It's hopefully we'll get future conversations and collaborations. I want to applaud the organizers for making sure that it wasn't just the converted talking to preaching to each other, that we had a range of opinions, a range of different perspectives coming here. We had a range of people from academics, to policy experts, to government officials, all trying to make sure we were as inclusive as we could be in the kinds of conversation that we put on. And I think they've done a great job in doing that. This last session is sort of a capstone, if you will, along that line. And so we're going to have two speakers, Dr. Bryan McCann, who's chair of the History Department, and John Judis, editor-at-large. They'll be introduced in greater detail. He's the editor of Talking Points Memo. Together, they're going to give us some perspectives on populism and policy from a historical perspective. First, looking at populism in the U.S. today to the 20th century movements in Latin America, and looking ahead. I think a lot of the panels, a number of the panels have had this historical context, but we have to understand where we came from. We have to understand how the situation got here before we can think about where we're going. And so I think having that context is an important part of the conversation. But in any case, I won't stand in the way of the experts any longer. I just want to thank all again for letting me come here and welcome you to this last panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dean Montgomery. So the way this is going to work is this is a two-person keynote. We're going to start with my favorite subject in undergrad, history, with Dr. Bryan McCann. And we're going to look at Latin American populism and tie it to the trends and how it relates to the United States today. So Dr. Bryan McCann teaches a course in colonial and modern Latin America, particularly in Brazil. And he's has lots of published works regarding Brazilian history. His book is right outside. You can buy it, you know, very convenient. It's Hard Times in the Marvelous City, from Dictatorship to Democracy in the Favelas of Rio de Janeiro. And we're going to start with him, and then after that, I'll introduce John B. Judis, and we'll save all questions till the end. So please jog in your brain or on the notepad, and we'll give you plenty of time opportunity for that. And Dr. Bryan McCann.
Thank you for coming. Thanks so much to Hall and all of the other organizers for doing such a wonderful job organizing this extremely impressive conference. And thanks to Dean Montgomery for welcoming me as well. It's a pleasure and an honor to be with you all today. And as Hall mentioned, I'll be talking about some of the similarities in the rise of Donald Trump to aspects of populism historically in Latin America. And I'll start with an anecdote about my first week at Georgetown when I arrived here in September of 2002 and found that the office across the hall from me was occupied by Francisco Nieto, who was a distinguished scholar from Venezuela. And we got to talking about current situation in Venezuela at the time. Hugo Chavez was strengthening his popularity there. The opposition had implemented a failed coup only a year or so before that, and that led to the real consolidation of Hugo Chavez and the marginalization of the opposition. And the opposition was desperately scrambling for a way to unseat Chavez at that time. And Francisco said something very revealing to me. He said, "One thing that my countrymen often don't understand is that las cosas siempre pueden piorar. Things can always get worse." And, well, I think it's very relevant. And I take it as a double-edged sword. Things are not as bad as they may immediately seem, but we need to be careful not to actually make them worse. In Venezuela, they did get worse, and they got worse in part because of the tactics of the opposition, which remained resolutely trying to unseat Chavez and very unsuccessful in terms of building a broader power base that could actually democratically remove Chavez, and that ended up backfiring. Most notably in 2005, when the opposition voluntarily withdrew from the electoral process and boycotted the congressional votes that year. It was a meaningful gesture, but also self-defeating, literally. Now, there are many comparisons that have been made between Hugo Chavez and Donald Trump, and they're usually superficial, and my colleagues in Latin American history tend to resist these very vociferously and would probably be disappointed that I'm even here talking about this and drawing some similarities. I do think that there are some striking similarities, and I'll come back to those in a minute. I take very seriously the argument of my co-panelist, John Judis. In fact, I'm entirely persuaded by John Judis's argument that in general, left-wing politics pursue a dyadic logic and employ a dyadic rhetoric where they imagine and rhetorically create a common people rising from below against a corrupt elite. And right-wing politics typically employ a triadic or a triangular logic where they imagine a common people fighting against a corrupt elite, but also fighting against the protected classes that that elite has created and depends upon. And in that model, Hugo Chavez would clearly be a left-wing populist, and Donald Trump would be a right-wing populist, and I think that that is generally applicable. And for me, the real similarities, yes, I'll get back to some striking similarities between Trump and Chavez, for example, but for me, the real striking similarities are actually between the Venezuelan opposition of the early 2000s and the current opposition to Donald Trump, of which I am a member, not surprising. The liberal coastal elite of New York, Washington, D.C., San Francisco, Los Angeles has much more in common with the liberal coastal elite of Caracas and Maracaibo than Trump's voters have in common with Hugo Chavez's voters. In fact, the liberal coastal elite of New York is the liberal coastal elite of Caracas. We go back and forth. That's part of what makes us this liberal class. I probably have the contacts of 10 members of the Venezuelan opposition in my iPhone, and that is not true of the typical Trump voter. Literally, they're not speaking the same language as the typical Chavez voter, but the differences are deeper than that. There's deeper ideological differences between the base of Trump's movement and the base of Chavez's movement, whereas the liberal coastal elite is actually very much moving back and forth and very much overlapping and seem to be very similar by those bases of the differing populist leader, seem to be possessing the sense of superiority, of outrage, of a sense of ownership, of logic and truth in the face of irrational popular movements and frequently moved by a reaction to cry foul, which can be counterproductive, as it was in Venezuela in 2005, for example. And we've been much less successful in confronting the real decline in the interior of the countries and understanding the problems that have led to successful electoral movements like Hugo Chavez or Donald Trump, for that matter. And I did bring one prop today, just in case you had any doubt where I stand on this. So, soulless globalist, this is how we are seen by the Trump base or the Hugo Chavez base. And I would put on the shirt if it weren't 80 degrees in here a little. But this is kind of where I fit in, right? And this is the background that I'm coming from. And my argument is that Latin America, well, the U.S. is Latin America. And I've been making this argument to my colleagues for years, that if you look at the Americas politically and culturally, the real outlier is not the United States. The real outlier is Canada. And I think recent developments have only underlined that difference. Now, historically, populism is a much stronger trend in Latin America than it has been in the U.S., but of course it's been evident in the U.S. as well. Looking back to some of the historical examples in Latin America, over the course of our presidential campaign in this last year, there were various moments that really recalled to me aspects of Latin American history and moments of Latin American history. There's a very iconic moment in Brazil in 1945 where the leading candidate for president, Brigadeiro Eduardo Gomes, Brigadier General from the Air Force, was a candidate favored by the middle class and really the globalizing class of Brazil in that period. And his opponent was a protege of Getúlio Vargas, the recently ousted populist dictator. And it really looked like the Brigadier General was going to win the election until less than 1 month before the election, in a speech at the Teatro Municipal, the opera house in Rio de Janeiro. That, you can see the problem right from the beginning. He should not have been giving a speech in the opera house. But in a speech at the opera house, he said something very dismissive about the opposition to his candidacy, and his opponent very quickly spun that as an insult and actually misquoted him and said that the Brigadier General is calling you all marmiteiros, lunchbox carriers, and he's dismissing you as lunchbox carriers. And that then became the slogan of the winning presidential campaign that defeated the Brigadier Generals. We are the marmiteiros, we are the lunchbox carriers. That was a moment that came back to me very vividly this September. There's a few moments in this recent presidential campaign that probably many of us wish we could come back, take back. But one that really struck me was Hillary Clinton's speech at the Cipriani Club on Wall Street, very similar to giving a speech at the Opera House in Rio de Janeiro, where she referred to half of Trump's voters as a basket of deplorables. And that was a disastrous mood. I hate to beat up on Hillary because obviously she suffered terrible consequences, but I recall that because it was a moment that I immediately knew, oh, this is just going to be a disaster. And indeed, it turned out to be a disaster. Obviously, several things unfolded after that. But deplorable then became very much like Marmiteiro, the lunchbox character, that carrier that became the mobilizing insult of this successful populist campaign. So what we need to do, and I say we meaning like soulless globalists like me, we need to convince those voters that we actually don't think they're deplorables, that we think that they are valued American citizens, and that we do share common ground and create some common vision for the country. And that is extremely difficult. I don't mean to be glib about it in any respect, but it starts with convincing the base that we are not just soulless globalists, but also red-blooded patriots. And so I will proudly wear this shirt on a less stifling afternoon to show that I am both soulless globalist and red-blooded patriot. And I will hold that duality. So beyond being glib about that, what does that mean? Well, it means recognizing that, yes, the kind of benefits of global trade and economic growth that have been the basis for a kind of consolidation of liberal coastal elite interests have often had disastrous consequences for the working class in the interior, and that we need to create a broader base that is going to decrease inequality. And if some of that involves infrastructural spending, for example, and massive infrastructural campaigns, although I'm extremely skeptical of Donald Trump's policies, I would entirely support infrastructural spending, of course. I imagine that I would differ on some of my priorities for that infrastructural spending, but I would like to see more of it if it's going to help consolidate our infrastructure and repair that, but also, yes, decrease inequality, create greater employment. And that can be a key to eliminating that massive gulf between the outraged base and the outraged opposition. That does bring up one of the difficulties, though, and this gets back to what I referred to earlier of what I do see as some very real similarities between Trump and Chavez. And some of my closest colleagues in Latin American history completely dismiss this on ideological grounds and say, no, Chavez and Trump are radically different ideologically. True enough, I find them strikingly similar in rhetorical style, and both geniuses at what they do. Well, Hugo Chavez is dead, of course, but both geniuses at that kind of rhetorical style. Very rare to see someone with that kind of skill of reading a room and reacting to what seems to be working with the crowd and playing off that and riffing off of that. And that's why these utterances, when they're printed in the newspaper the next day, look completely nonsensical, because much of the time the populist politician is just spinning this and seeing how the crowd is reacting and then moving in a different direction based on that. Many moments in Trump's presidential campaign really made that very clear. And that's very different. That's very difficult to fight logically. We can't give up the logical fight, but we have to recognize that we are not the owners of logic, and we have to recognize that logic alone will not resolve this impasse. It will also take patience and a more patient electoral outreach, a more patient building of a base of opposition. And in that regard, I'm frequently wary of many of the calls that I've seen already for impeachment of Donald Trump. First of all, to my mind, I haven't seen anything impeachable, even remotely impeachable. I don't doubt that we will see something tilting towards that direction at some point in the next 4 years. That would not surprise me. I would be very worried of any movement for impeachment that was not very firmly grounded in something that was clearly and verifiably treasonous, because I don't want to reproduce those same mistakes of the Venezuelan opposition, for example, of that insistence on removal that almost takes the place of the more patient ground game. And that, again, gets back to where I started. Things can always get worse. It may seem that we're in this catastrophe that demands urgent action, and it demands committed action, yes, but beware the perils of calls for immediate change, especially change through removal. And in that regard, I want to close by citing Guillermo O'Donnell, one of the great political scientists of Latin America, and somebody who really revealed the workings of authoritarian governments in Brazil, but also probing electoral politics in Latin America very successfully. I'll close with this quotation from Guillermo O'Donnell from an article of his in 1977, stating simply one of the basic tenets of democratic stability. And here's the quotation. Those who occupy the highest positions in democratic government should not suffer termination of their mandate before the legally established term. Sometimes that's very difficult to accept when you feel like the president in power is illegitimate. But beware that deep peril of a backfire, because merely removing Trump does not resolve any of these problems. The deeper problems are reducing inequality and recreating that sense of some kind of shared foundation. And with that, I'll close. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. McCann. Now we're going to move looking into the future with John B. Judis. He is an author and American journalist, currently an editor at large at Talking Points Memo, former senior writer at National Journal, and former senior editor at New Republic. So his book, for a cool $13, is The Populist Explosion, How the Great Recession Transformed American and European Politics, and which you can get outside right there after this, or when we feel like it. And without further ado, Mr. John B. Judis.
Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just move it. That was an interesting talk. We were discussing this before, and I agree with the Chavez Trump rhetorical thing, and I'll get around to it later. Why? Because I have an additional reason why I think they're similar. I started writing this book here in, I got the contract in May of 2015, and I had to talk the publisher into letting me include the United States in the book. Because I'm an expert in American history. I don't have any intentions about being a great expert in Europe, but did go over there and stuff. And, so he gave in. And then fast forward about 4 months, 3 months, my wife and I go to New Hampshire every summer in August. And it was August 2015, and I was dragging her to all these presidential events. We went to, Hillary, Rand Paul, Scott Walker, and finally, we went to see Trump, and it was in Hampton, New Hampshire, at the high school. And we arrived about 45 half hour early, and there was already a line. It was like, if you could imagine, they were giving free tickets for Hamilton. New York. There was like 200 yards of people stretched out. And it was at that moment that I thought, well, something is really happening here. And then when I heard Trump again, Oreo cookies. You know about Oreo cookies? Nabisco, Chicago firm, was moving its plant to Mexico. And Trump said, he vowed not to eat Oreo cookies anymore. He attacked Ford. He attacked Carrier. He talked about bad trade deals. And I was listening, and what I heard was not Hitler or somebody like that, or a conventional Republican, but Ross Perot, somebody who I admired from 1992. And it was at that moment I started to think that this was a very unusual campaign. And of course, then I went and saw Sanders. So that was, I had the first half of my book at that point. Now let me go back and just talk a little about what populism is and why I think we are in this unusual political period. Like Bryan said, the basic idea of populism is this conflict between the people, and the people can be the poor, the middle class, what have you, and the elite. And the elite itself can be, and right now, the New York Times and CNN, it can be Washington, it can be the billionaire class, Bernie Sanders, whatever. What's important is the relationship, not the precise terms of it. It's different from liberalism. Liberalism and liberals seem to reconcile interests with more of an eye towards the poor and the working class, perhaps, but still, it's a politics basically of reconciliation of pluralism. Business conservatives, Republicans, see the world from the standpoint of business. Populism, again, is different. It's this relationship based upon political conflict. Now, as Bryan mentioned, I make a distinction between left and right, but I'm going to make that distinction, then I'm going to take it away. Left-wing Sanders, the people versus the billionaire class. The original populace, again, the people versus the money power. But more right, the right-wing populace, Marine Le Pen in France, Trump here, George Wallace in the late 1960s, also see a conflict between the people and the elite, but they add this third term. And the third term, it can be African Americans, Muslims, illegal immigrants, and these are the people that the elite is coddling. So that the people in this sense find themselves besieged from above and below. And that's very characteristic of this right-wing populist out. Now, let me take it back a little. If you look at the right-wing populace, if you look at Marine Le Pen or Trump or the Danish Folk Party or Geert Wilders in Holland, you make a very surprising discovery, which is to say, and in many respects, they're echoing themes from the left. Again, I said about Trump, runaway shops, companies that move overseas and leave their workers in the lurch. They had trade deals that screw American workers and put them out of work. His first press conference after winning the election, drug companies. He went after drug companies for their pricing. Again, these are things you would hear from Bernie Sanders as well. Marine Le Pen's platform in France is somewhat to the left of the Democratic Party. Capping credit card charges, nationalization of the banks if they misbehave, universal health care, in this case, for everyone regardless of income and regardless of where they live. So way beyond even the French system. So there's this kind of strange mixture in these right-wing populists of left and right. They're not normal. When you say Trump is not a normal Republican, that's absolutely true. He's not a normal Republican. In Europe, political parties can stick around for a long time. So, you've had right-wing populist parties with 5 or 6% of the vote, and then all of a sudden they spurt up because you have multi-party systems. The United States, we have a two-party system where everything sort of goes to the center, and it's only at moments of crisis that you suddenly get these populist upsurges. Now, what these consist of and why they happen in the United States is they occur at times when the prevailing view that's held by leaders of both parties suddenly becomes in disrepute, and where there is a kind of looming popular revolt against it, which a party, a candidate, captures. 1890s, the original populist movement, where populism gets its name from, the People's Party in the United States. Reaction against laissez-faire capitalism, the idea that you could just let the firms be as they were, you could have a fairly chaotic banking system, you didn't need regulation of capitalism, a reaction against that. And it's a reaction that is really something that it takes like 30 or 40 years for the demands themselves to be met. Now let's go to the last 40 years. What is occurring now? After World War II, in both the Europe and the United States, we have this incredible period of prosperity. And I'm going to simplify it, but you know, you can make it complicated yourselves. The basic philosophy in Europe and the United States is something like New Deal liberalism and social democracy, even if the Republicans are in charge in the United States or the Christian Democrats in Europe. And the idea is that if you raise workers' wages, if you raise demand, that will in turn increase profits. Profits will be the basis of more revenue and the basis of higher wages and so on, a kind of virtuous circle driven by demand. 1970s, you get a crisis in both Europe and the United States. You know, remember the energy crisis. You get increased competition globally. Again, Japan and Western Europe become pretty much equal competitors of the United States from that point. And you get very strong labor movements in the United States and in Western Europe pressing upwards on profits. And you get a new kind of economic philosophy emerging as the economy itself plunges into a combination of unemployment and inflation. And, you know, in the United States, we talk about supply side economics, and that's why I talk demand supply. Europe, they talk about neoliberalism. I use the term sometimes market liberalism to describe what becomes the prevailing view. And what it consists of is the idea that if you lower costs of capital, if you raise profit rates, that in turn will redound to the masses, to wages and taxes. So it's an idea that, as Reagan put it, a rising tide will lift all boats. The key components of it, first, corporate mobility. The idea that a corporation can move wherever it wants in the world in search of lower costs, higher profits, and it will eventually come back to help the home country. Labor mobility, and this is important. The idea that workers can go wherever they want. This is the year, beginning in 1965, you get this incredible influx of immigration into the United States as we change our immigration laws. Europe as well, same thing. That again, especially among the lower half of the workforce, acts in order to depress wages. Make possible higher rates of profit. In addition, you get deregulation of finance, you get reduction of corporate taxes, and you know, as you remember, this is not something that the Republicans alone embrace. Very characteristic, again, of the Clinton administration in the United States, Tony Blair in Britain, Mitterrand in France makes this great U-turn in the early 1980s and goes from this more demand side to supply side, from socialism, in effect, to a kind of economics of austerity. So it becomes the prevailing wisdom. And, you know, in the 80s, as we recover from this very deep recession, it's popular. It's a popular idea. But with the first big recession in 1991, which is not that deep, but it's long-lasting in many ways, it's still going on in 1995, 96, in some respects, you get the first burst of populism. You get Perot and you get Buchanan. In 1996 or so, you get the internet boom. And Buchanan is a big deal. I was at the famous Pitchforks and Peasants speech in Nashua, New Hampshire, where he wins the New Hampshire primary. But then, like a month later, the unemployment rate starts to fall dramatically, and you get the beginning of the boom. And during that boom period, populism dies off, and Perot and Buchanan basically disappear as viable candidates. Then you get the 9/11, the concentration on a threat from outside. terrorism, 2008, the Great Recession, and we have another upsurge of populism. We get the Tea Party, we get Occupy, and then we get Sanders and we get Wall Street. So basically, what you have there is upsurges that happen only at these moments when a prevailing view suddenly comes into disrepute. And that's where you, why we get from 2008 to the present, this tremendous burst of populism in the United States. Now, I kept asking myself, and I nobody would ask me this question, so I finally asked it myself and gave the answer, why in 2016-17, when unemployment is going down, do we still have this kind of populist reaction? Isn't, as Obama and Hillary Clinton used to say, everything rosy, America is great, you know, what's the problem? And I cite two things that are important. I'm going to give you a statistic here that I discovered. Alan Krueger, he was the head of the Council of Economic Advisors, and Lawrence Katz, a Harvard economist, they're both, you know, really liberals. They did this recent study of part-time, temporary, and contract employees. In other words, not people who are W-2s, you know what W-2s versus Schedule Cs, not staff people who get benefits and all this other stuff. And what they found was a striking implication of these estimates is that all of the net employment growth in the U.S. economy from 2005 to 2015 appears to have occurred in alternative work arrangements. Just incredible. And I want you to think about that, not so much in terms of Trump, but in terms of Sanders and the Sanders voters. You are young people, you look forward to the future. It's not, things are not so certain anymore. It's a niche economy, it's very specialized. There aren't these great blocks of employment that you can go to and count on being employed for the rest of your life at the same job. Things are very chaotic, very uncertain. Again, I think that's a leftover, that's a survival of the period of the Great Recession, and has fueled the kind of economic anxiety that in particular lifted Sanders. Now, with Trump, again, if you look at his vote in the swing states and match it up with where manufacturing jobs were lost from 2000 to 2015, there's almost an exact match. The biggest state to lose jobs was Michigan, okay? What do you think the second biggest was?
Wisconsin.
Florida. No.
Ohio.
Keep going. It's a state that he wasn't supposed to win that he won.
Pennsylvania.
North Carolina. But also, I mean, obviously, yes, Pennsylvania. And all the South, too. You know, it's not just that they're not just all rednecks or racist. That was the South, Alabama, Georgia, those were also states, Mississippi, that lost a tremendous amount of manufacturing jobs. So there's an astonishing match there between these kind of swing states that Trump wins and the loss of manufacturing jobs. And what comes with it? The disintegration of communities. So you put that together with the other factor. I mentioned labor mobility, illegal immigration, and add to it a third factor, Islamic terrorism. So if you put those together, again, the question about immigration and Islamic terrorism, you get an explosion. An explosion of concern and worry that Trump himself, Marine Le Pen in France, even more so, I think, in Europe than in the United States. But among Trump voters, again, if you talk to them, illegal immigrants is way up, very high on the list of things that they're concerned about. So that's, again, that's why we have this, what's happening now in the United States. I talked a little about Sanders voters and this economic anxiety. Let me describe a little who the Trump voters are. Because I think I always get these questions about, aren't they all racist and isn't white nationalism the main issue, et cetera, et cetera. But I don't think that's the right way to see it. There's a sociologist named Donald Warren, who only made it to associate professor, who wrote one of the best books about American politics. I think it's called The Radical Center. You'll be lucky if it's in your library. And Warren did these surveys, extensive, like several thousand people in 1971 and 1976. And what he found was a peculiar slice of the electorate that had gone for Wallace in 68 and 72, and were really the base of George Wallace's support. George Wallace, again, race is a big issue, but also he was a New Deal liberal. And these voters were, not surprisingly, slightly more male than female, older rather than younger. They had graduated from, they had not gotten any farther than high school. Now if you move them up, they would have gone to some college for, let's say, a trade school, junior college, or to a more modest college, not Georgetown. And what characterized their outlook was this sense of being besieged, of being in the middle, of being betrayed both by the upper class, we're getting all these tax breaks, etc., and by the people that the upper class was protecting. In the case of Wallace, it was African Americans. This was the era of civil rights movement. Now, this group of voters moves through the electorate from 1968 to the present. You can think of them as a large animal that a python swallows. And you know, when pythons swallow, they don't get digested. You can see the body moving through the electorate. And in late 1970s, it's the basis of the tax revolt in California and elsewhere. 1980s, the beginning of the opposition to illegal immigration. Starts in Texas, moves to California in the 1990s. Christian coalition, gun rights. In the early 2000s, Islamism, the war on terror. And in the wake of the Great Recession, this combination of economic anxiety and fear of illegal immigrants and terror. Now, if you look at it, it's a very complex group. And if you were to be able to x-ray the mentality of these people at any given time, you'd find all these different avenues. You know, racism, economic anxiety, et cetera, et cetera. But what really distinguishes our period is not some kind of white nationalism vis-a-vis Barack Obama, but again, these concerns about the economy, manufacturing being left behind, and about illegal immigrant, Islamic immigrants sneaking into the country, blowing up things. That's the central concern. Now, Trump. Let me talk about Trump. Am I going too long? Good. Am I okay? Okay. Let me have a drink.
Need something strong in the
I know. Whiskey last one. Trump is, you know, as you're learning, a very complicated guy. He starts out as a new, pretty typical middle-of-the-road New York Democrat. Ed Koch, people like that. He's a registered Democrat. And, you know, if he's close to a Republican, if you ever, any of you remember Al D'Amato, he's very similar to Al D'Amato. You know, for the welfare state, he believes in many elements of neoliberalism. At one point was in favor of a single-payer system. So, not a conventional Republican at all. The second thing about Trump is this combination of economic nationalism and, if I could call it, military nationalism that runs through his thought from the 1980s on. It's not something that he's just adopted for the campaign. I'll get to things that he just adopted for the campaign. Trump and I are the same generation, and we grew up with the same kind of experience, which was if we went into a store in the 1950s or the 1960s, what we did was we looked for goods that were made in America. They had the made in the USA sign. And we didn't do it out of any patriotism whatsoever. We did it because those were the best things. Other kind, you know, Japanese stuff, that was just crap, you know, it was like knockoffs and stuff like that. The Germans, you know, might have made cameras, but you didn't buy them for other reasons. So there was, so the, again, made in the USA, 1970s, 1980s, 1980s, it's a tremendous shock when suddenly you go into these stores and you have to, if you want to buy a television, it's, you know, made in Japan, Zenith is no longer exists. That's central again to this conception that Trump has of making America great again. And that resonates with the older voters. It resonates with me. I hear that stuff and I say, wow. I mean, I used to think what began in Perot had the same thing. Remember, Perot talked about made in the USA as central. And again, it's, as you know, it's a central part of Trump's outlook. I mean, the other thing was that I grew up at a time when, you know, On Memorial Day, everybody, there were big parades in Chicago, and you went out and lined the streets, and there was just this sense of triumphalism about our military. Trump has a lot of that, and I don't think it's that he went to military school. I think, again, it's this incredible respect for the military and for generals. And again, it's another way in which he wants to make America great again. So I think that that theme comes out of Trump's own experience, and I think it resonates with a lot of voters. There's a lot of younger voters who thought that it was just nonsense, and the Clinton people thought it was ridiculous. You know, isn't America great as it is? But no, I think that's something real. Now, the other thing about Trump is that he decides in 2011 or so to run for president. And at that point, he starts to develop positions that he thinks would appeal to the Republican electorate. That's the point at which he starts talking about the birther stuff with Obama. And he adopts these positions in the primary itself, for instance, about Obamacare. I don't think he gives a damn about, you know, I mean, really. But Obamacare is a disaster. This is a position you had to have in order to run in the Republican primary. Abortion, he was pro-choice. So again, you have these three elements of Trump, the old time Democrat, the economic and military nationalist, and the opportunist. And then he wins the presidency. Now, I'm nearing the end here, so because he's now becoming president. you see in a lot of, here we come with Chavez, because you see in some populace, when they actually win, of course, logically, they become part of the establishment. And they have to face the same problems. And, you know, it might take a month or 2 months, but they become, in effect, the people that they displaced. Syriza, the party in Greece, they take power on the basis of saying that the socialists have sold out the country to the Troika, you know, the European Central Bank and the IMF. And the European Commission, the EU. And that if they get into power, they're going to defy these people, and they're not going to, they're going to get the Greece's debts reduced, and so on and so on. So they win, you know, they get into office, and they find out that they can't do a damn thing. They're now in the same position, in effect, as the Socialist Party was, and they're going to get kicked out of office. And a lot of their rhetoric has completely lost its steam. Now, I expected when Trump won, I even expected this when he won the nomination, then when he got, that he would saw off the rough edges of his rhetoric. That in effect, he wouldn't continue as a president to be a populist. But to my great surprise, he has, and he's running a very hard-edged presidency. And this is the Chavez thing, that's the similarity. Chavez governed. He didn't just run as a candidate, he governed as a populist. And that's in effect, that's what Trump is doing. The attacks on Washington, now the attacks on the press, again, very characteristic, splitting things into the people versus them, the us versus them. So, question is, how long is he going to be able to sustain it? What's its effect? His base, his solid base is maybe, I don't know, I should go through the polls and look at this more carefully. It may be 25%, 30% of the electorate, that is to say the people I was talking about. A lot of his other voters were people who couldn't stand Hillary Clinton or who were traditional Republicans and were going to vote Republican regardless. Is this guy going to be able to sustain it? I would look at a few things. I would look at his relationship to Congress, to the leadership in Congress, and how he manages to navigate Obamacare, Medicare, and Social Security, all these things that in one way or another the Republican leadership, especially in the House, wants to gut. Because if he does those things wrongly, he's going to be in deep trouble, no matter how inept the Democrats are. I would look to see whether he can get his tax and infrastructure program. I think if he can do that, it will give a boost to the economy, and he, you know, might be able to avoid a downturn in the next 4 years, and that would put him in a pretty good shape. And you know, I would see about this his program of economic nationalism. As you might know, he's already backed down on the China and the currency. How much is he going to be able to do that? You know, there's a case of Argentina where they used a tax in order to make firms manufacture in Argentina. Now, the United States is in a much better position to do that. He might be able to pull that off, and more power to him than he actually does. But he's got a long haul in front of him trying to do that. Because now he's got to work not only with his own mind and his advisors, but with Congress. And again, his relationship, especially with the Senate Republicans, are going to be very rocky. But so far, I wouldn't sell him short. I think it's very possible that he could manage in the next 4 years to stay afloat. And I think it's very hard. I'll just say something bad in closing. I think that the left-wing populace are in a more difficult position because really what they're calling for are very important structural changes in capitalism itself. Especially in Europe, with talking about the European Union and the whole relationship with the euro. But what the right-wing populace can always do is they can use the scapegoats, they can use that other element to keep their popularity up, particularly with their base. And the left doesn't have that as much. So again, I think we might be in over the next decade for much more of a trend toward the right than the left. So that's my two bits.
At this time, we'll open up to about 15, 20 minutes of questions. So, McCann, please come up. And you guys can pick your party favorite one at a time. I'll start. We've just been talking about McCann. Pick who? Question.
So, I'm a staff member here. So, certainly, Trump has populist rhetoric and around jobs, around the Obamacare and some other, and Medicare, and, you know, which the claim is will help working people. Yet, it seems if a lot of this stuff is enacted, really, really actually hurts is the work. It takes away their health care. Restrictive trade is going to raise prices. It was the Democrats over the massive protests of the Republicans that bailed out successfully GM Ford. And you know, you could go on, and Medicare, I mean, if they send to a block grant, or they send Medicaid to a block grant, eventually it's going to strip away the value of it because it won't increase, and the taxes are going to result in state taxes going up, I think, and also less services.
We got the drift. It's going to actually make things worse, right?
For the very people who believe
it's
going to make
things worse.
Neither of you. How does it work?
I think I'll go with that. Joe, I agree. I think that is the most likely outcome. But I think what John is also bringing to a very clear light here is that if Trump can keep doing the things he's doing, he'll still be able to blame that on the people that he's blaming it on all along. So there's still going to be a gap between Trump's base facing increasing material difficulties because of some of those policies that get implemented and persuading that base that that's the cause of those worsened material circumstances, and therefore we have to look for different policies.
Okay, well, I'm going to give a different answer because I actually think some of his things could help. Leave aside, you know, obviously there's things that won't. I'm not as averse to this tax deal that both he and the House are talking about, where we use our tax system in order to encourage manufacturing here, in order to encourage exports. I think that's, you know, I don't think that's on its surface a bad idea. Again, the infrastructure stuff. Help. It depends whether he can actually get it through Congress. China. There's a big problem in the international economic system with Germany and China running these huge surpluses. We let China, basically the most favored nation, and then WTO with this promise that we would get all these jobs. And, you know, I'm sure you've seen estimates of up to 4 million manufacturing jobs lost in 2015. So something could be done. Something about the currency, who knows whether he'll be able to do it. But I wouldn't rule out the fact that his economic program couldn't help the people that voted for him. So, you know, that's my... Yeah. Happens in life, you know, I have this job.
So the common question that I've heard from friends here in D.C. is, to what extent can we believe what Donald Trump says? I've heard on the right that opponents take him literally, but not figuratively. Supporters take him figuratively, but not literally. You know, there have been some attacks against judiciary across. To what extent is this some of that campaign rhetoric, you know, that you talked about, and to what extent is it a vision of whatever kind for the future that we can expect?
He's done a lot of what he said he would do. I think that that's absolutely true. The immigration orders, I mean, you know, he's not going to deport 11 million people. And, you know, there'll be a fence sometimes, but if you look at his... at the immigration directive on legal immigration that was just put out, it's very draconian. It's very tough. In effect, you know, if one of you are in the country illegally and you've been here 15 years and you get caught speeding, you could be tossed out of the country. I mean, I'm not saying that it's going to be interpreted that way by your local policeman, but it could be. It's a very sweeping order. That stuff he has. I think that they're trying on the economic nationalism. If you look at there's a core group of people, Bannon, Leitzinger, Navarro, and who's the fourth? Oh, of course, Ross, the Secretary of Commerce, who are all committed to this idea that we have to do something to revive American manufacturing. And I do not think that that's a bad idea or it's just nostalgia. Even if it doesn't bring millions of jobs, that's high value added goods. It's exports. It's things that have a great multiplier that will create jobs elsewhere in a way that if you do a health club, it might not work quite that way. So it's good. Let's see, I have more power to them. And there are a lot of high-tech goods, machine tools, hearing aids, things like that Americans don't produce very well and that they should be producing. So if they can pull that off, great, you know. And to some extent, I think that his appointments reflect a continuing concern with that. It's just that already they've run into roadblocks.
And on the civil, social, and institutional side, not just the economic.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's...
Do you have any thoughts? Can we expect that? Should we be... Is that a dream or a nightmare?
One thing I want to say, in keeping with the idea that things can only get worse, is although, yes, I see a tremendous amount of similarity between Donald Trump and the Latin American populace, I've been wrong over and over and over again over the last year. So,
that's true.
Yeah. So I wouldn't even hesitate to make a prediction that I think we are in turbulent waters, I guess I would say. But yeah, I've took that criticism to heart that the opposition makes a mistake by taking Trump literally and not seriously. And again, that did remind me of Chavez, where this is what Chavez would do in his speeches before the Venezuelan populace, is intentionally say something outrageous that would trigger a reaction, and that would dominate the news cycle. Meanwhile, he was accomplishing other things to cater to his base, frankly, that were not getting as much attention because the attention was all on the outrageous statement. And it's very difficult to fight that because the statements can be truly outrageous and the statements can have serious implications as well. So that's another thing I was trying to show with that soulless globalist slash red-blooded patriot, that struggling against this requires a dual approach of, yes, engaging on the rhetorical level, but also working hard on that more material level.
And then we'll go over there.
Sounds good.
He got cheated out.
It seems that there's a lot
You're
of
from right.
It seems that there's a lot of debate over whether or not this populist movement could have coalesced around somebody other than Donald Trump. And what worries me is that this could continue in perpetuity even after Donald Trump is gone 4 or 8 years and after he goes away, if he goes away. Do you believe that this movement could actually exist with somebody other than Donald Trump or even without any single individual?
No, if you heard, my analysis again is no. That it's a burst, it's an explosion. And at some point, things will come to earth. It might come to earth in a way that none of us want. That is to say, there'll be a consolidation among the nation's rulers of some of the things that Trump is advocating. Just as you could say with the New Deal, there was a consolidation of populism from the 1890s and beyond, but the populists themselves went into the woodwork. So no, I don't think so. And I didn't see another candidate out there who would pull it off the way Trump did.
I would agree with that. It's very difficult to pass the mantle of charismatic leadership, as Nicolas Maduro has found. And so someone inheriting that base from Trump is unlikely. I think we'll see a lot of people trying to mobilize in the same way, but again, cautiously, I would say, yeah, it's unlikely for both the circumstantial reasons and the individual reasons that we would see something very similar.
Rose?
Yeah. Okay, Professor McCann, I really like the point about really cautioning the left in the United States not to overreact by calling for impeachment at this very early stage. I think there is a tendency to overreact and be hysterical, but I'd like to ask both of you what you think the most effective form of resistance is. I mean, I think there's a real danger of burnout on the left. I think that there's a real danger that that the Republicans might bring back economic prosperity and ensure generations of Republicans in the presidency, but yet we might lose our constitutional rights. So did anything work in Brazil? And John, did anything work in the 60s? I don't know,
Go ahead.
this is a challenge that many of us have been facing, right? Especially if we live in a blue state, as I do, in an entirely blue district, and the sense as well, you know, where do we turn to? But I still think that, yes, putting pressure on our legislators, even if they're elected Democrats, still makes sense and can make a huge difference. And there is a risk of burnout, but given what has been achieved in fighting back against the executive order, for example, it shows that popular pressure can be extremely successful. And this is a crucial difference, for example, between Trump and Chavez. I mean, Chavez did have the support of the majority of the country, and Trump does not. As John was saying, if you actually look at the base, it would be 20-25%. And so let's say maybe that's low. Let's say it's 40%, but we know that it's not a majority, right? So if the majority continues to mobilize, we can check some of these dangers. How to then, say, flip from red to blue in some of those swing states like Michigan, Wisconsin, only that one for the other, I guess.
So I'm not going to dwell on tactics. I spent about 7 or 8 years as a professional revolutionary. We still have capitalism. So. Rosie. Let me say two things. The first is that the best chance that the Democrats have, again, is if the Republicans and Trump touch one of these third rail issues, like Medicare, Social Security, or if they completely screw up Obamacare. And I would take you back to the election in 1994 when Republicans sweep the House, and then the next year, Gingrich does this big budget cut thing, where it turns out he's cutting Medicare and using the funds in order to finance a tax cut for the wealthy. And that's the moment in which Bill Clinton completely recovers, you know, wins the presidency. And they inch back from that bit. So I think, again, if Trump stumbles in that way, or if there's immense gridlock in Washington, if he can't get things done, it's very possible that the Democrats will come back 2018, even if the calendar is very bad, there's only 8 Democratic Senate seats up, 22 Republican Senate, something like that. So in that sense, the best offense at this point is going to be a strong defense, and I can't tell you what form it takes. My worry about the Democrats and about the left, liberals in the United States, is that while the Republican base is rooted in institutions, the churches, the NRA and the gun clubs, the chambers of commerce. The Democrats, who were once dependent upon what? Labor unions, city machines, the White South, again, political machines, Catholic Church was very important. Except for the labor movement, all those things are pretty much gone, and the labor movement is just a shell of itself. And it's, you know, most active parts are public workers, and they're always put in a very bad situation because they're basically their employers are the taxpayers. So it's very easy to pit one against the other. So the thing is, in terms of the long term, I worry that the Democrats don't have the basis for sustaining things. So, you know, they might come back in 2018 or 2020, but again, you know, the Republicans have this advantage way in the back, and then the party.
Yeah, I think that.
Yeah,
I think Obama upended that whole concept of the Democrats not having labor unions and city machinery. So,
I mean, the Democrats now, after 8 years of Obama, are in the worst position that they've been since the 1920s.
Well, that was an individual who was able to do that.
Well,
but I have another question.
Yeah.
Do you think it's possible that someone like Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, can mobilize millennials, groups of people like Obama did, to actually challenge capitalism, especially in the face of a possible another financial meltdown, which probably is coming soon?
I would say to challenge capitalism, I don't see it happening, but to create a meaningful challenge from the left, sure, I think that's entirely possible. And let's, so just to come back for a minute and imagine this not happening at the level of a single charismatic individual running for president, but some of the other congressional developments. One of the positive, to me, in my opinion, one of the positive developments of the recent election was the election of my congressional representative, Jamie Raskin, in Maryland, who's somebody who is not characteristic of the traditional Democratic Party. He's someone who I think is characteristic of an engaged new left. And I think he was very successful as a Maryland state senator and against odds, despite the fact that Maryland was entirely Democratic. He was representing a younger wing of the Democratic Party in Maryland, which is very different than the old guard. And he's not alone. There's a number of other members of Congress in that same cohort. And so I think even if we're lacking a single national level figure who's likely to lead that movement in the next few years, to have create more of that base and create the foundation for meaningful change.
Well, I was a Bernie voter myself, so I'm allowed to say this, but I think he might have lost worse than Hillary. And that the issues that he pressed, which were I agreed with and which his voters agreed with, are still not at the level where they can win majorities nationally. And the thing I would point you to is the Colorado. Colorado, they had a single-payer health care initiative. It would have done, you know, for Colorado, what Bernie's thing did, it would have done for the United States. And Bernie came and endorsed it and everything like that. Democrats were leery of it because it was going to raise taxes. You know, it's going to. I mean, the argument is, well, you raise taxes, but over the long run, you do better because you're not paying the same kind of premiums. Business opposed it. It lost 80 to 20. Now, what I'm getting at there is there's just still this kind of nature of distrust of government, high taxes. So that's why I say that for the short, at least for the short and midterm, the Democrats' best chance is defensive and not offensive. It's for Trump to do really bad stuff and for the Democrats to be able to mobilize, and not just mobilize a particular interest group, but mobilize on behalf of the citizens. So that's the...
John, I'll go with two more questions. You can pick one from the undergrads, and then pick one from the
right
adults.
There, he says.
Sure. So Wolfie talked about how populism is characterized as a movement of, you know, the people versus this wealthier elite. My question is, how do Trump supporters differentiate him from that elite? Because he is a billionaire. He did start his business with a $1 million loan from his dad, and he also filled his cabinet with Goldman Sachs executives. So, how do his supporters view him as different from that elite and separate from that elite that they were fighting against?
Yeah. Perot was a billionaire, too. And the fact that they were self-financed was an important part of their appeal. And they could say to their people, we're not going to be dependent upon the special interests. Look at Hillary Clinton, Goldman Sachs, all this stuff. So he has these people that he's appointed, and I'm shocked myself about how many Goldman Sachs people there were. He outdid Bill Clinton, but I think still he's got his appeal on those terms just because of that. It's on behalf of whom he says he's representing. When he betrays that, then he'll lose his appeal. People will start saying, oh, we just got the same old, you know, selfish millionaires.
But then why did Hillary get in so much trouble when she spoke on Wall Street at that one event? Why did she get criticized for that, but when Trump's kind of part of that?
But they were giving her money, remember? They gave her, I mean, I didn't get several hundred thousand dollars for speaking here. I tried.
budgets.
We'll be on YouTube.
That was the idea that she was, in some way, was allowing herself to be bought, and that when, if she were elected, these people would have special access. The people from Goldman Sachs that he appointed were not the big contributors on which he depended. There are a few people that are that suspicious nature that will, like this guy who's going to Austria, who likes the sound of music, was a contributor, those kind of people. But again, I think he's clear still on that. Still. declare himself as a populist even though he's a billionaire.
But you're bringing up logical inconsistencies, which are very true. And I think that that's not unusual for populism, and specifically in the context of Latin American populism, for example. Latin American populists on the right are often figures of the wealthy business class as well. But in this case, Trump represented that will to uproot the current system, and Hillary represented continuity. And that's what made the difference.
Okay, who's the last question? It has to be an undergraduate because we call that all hope.
Yeah, so you guys both talked a little bit about the issue of trade. Concurrent, though, the rise of free trade with the rise of automation, which has caused quite a few manufacturing and other sort of low-skilled labor jobs. So I'm curious what you guys think about Trump's restricted trade policies. Will it actually bring it back, or are those jobs gone permanently because of the improvements in technology?
Some are gone permanently, but some aren't. And I would say, you know this group, ITIF, it's the Institute for what? I can't remember. Bob Adkinson runs it in Washington. Remember the initials?
Technology Institute.
Yes. And they've done a study of this. You can bring back some jobs. Not, again, automation is not going to clear the factory floors. But again, there's all these other benefits for manufacturing that I would look at. High value added, tax revenues, things like that. So there's a reason for doing it, even if you're not going to bring back millions of jobs.
Nothing further to add to that.
I thank all the questions and remarks that have been made for 2017 McCourt Policy Conference. Before our speakers leave, I'd like to give you, Mr. Judis, a Georgetown member. And for you, Dr. McCann, I know you are in Georgetown, but you can think fondly of this conference at Policy School. I know we're a long ways away, but yeah, you're always welcome, McCann. All right, and I'm glad for everyone to show up. Hope you had a good time. Please, this is a great time to get your spring break reading done outside. They might even be able to autograph it. This could get your kids' tuition paid, maybe like 1/80th, 1/100th of it in the future. And at this point, we will adjourn. Thank you very much.